Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Yeah, we're working. Good morning. Good to see everyone. I know we have some out in the parking lot, perhaps in the classroom. I don't know about the annex, but if you're listening on the live stream this afternoon, just know that we have quite a few spaces open in here, so don't be reluctant to come. And we have the places in the classroom, the annex set up, so we encourage you to get out. You know, David said, I was glad when they said to me, not sad, not unhappy. I was glad when they said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Psalm 122, verse 1. So by your being here today, I trust that you feel the same way David did. On our prayer list, let's remember our brothers and sisters in the Philippines. There is a bulletin out front in the foyer if you haven't picked it up. But I want to mention these, the ACU and CHC campus for our students and orphans. Only got minimal damage. They really were spared. But the typhoon hit other parts of the Philippines where we have brethren. And so our students and staff at ACU will get in those vans and they'll go out and take food and water and medicines. They've already been, DMAR's been in touch with Junis, and they have some funds to do that. I will say we try to keep that fund up because they have typhoons there every year. And so just see Mike or one of the, Mike or Kevin or myself if you'd like to help in any way. But we're so glad that while the school was spared, they're able to go and serve their fellow man and the congregations in the Pamasanan area. Let's remember June and Wayne Isaac. This is Chad Isaac's parents who were tested positive with the virus. They live in Kingston, and I believe they are home. Lenny and Luke Hobart, Johnny and Martha's grandson, son and grandson, who also have the COVID. And Velvet, who's recovering from two recent surgeries. Let's just pray that they all mend well and recover. Again, remember Tyler Sutton as he continues to improve in Atlanta, and his family, Autumn and Brady and the little girl on her way, and Sean Mallory and Faye and Sabrina, all that family.
Steve, I believe that Chad's father has been hospitalized.
Chad Isaac's father has been hospitalized. I didn't realize that. So certainly we need, their health is not the best, so we need to certainly remember them. We're thankful that some who've had the virus are doing better, and that includes Danny McNutt. Skip, I don't know that he was ever tested, but he had some symptoms, and he's feeling better too. Robbie Eversall, the preacher at Pennville Church of Christ, doing some better also. I want to mention Sheila's husband again, Rebecca's dad. Danny, who had the cataract surgery and had bleeding in his left eye, really couldn't see there for a while, but it's beginning to clear up so that he can at least see, but he still needs our prayers, and let's do that. Also, I want to mention, if you haven't been back in the hallway lately, go back there and see the wall. And Mary has prepared that wall with our pictures, and there are other pictures. You'll see vacancies of names of people who need to have their picture taken, and if you're one of those, just talk to Mary and try to set up a time where you can have your picture made so it can be put on the wall of fame out there. Let's take a song book out as we enter into our worship together.
Humble yourselves inside the Lord. Humble yourselves inside the Lord. Oh, do not our suit this time.
397. 397.
Amen.
you would turn in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. For God is not unjust to forget your work and labor of love, which you have shown toward his name, and that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. We will now have opening prayer.
Let's pray. Father, we are so thankful this morning that we were able to assemble here and be able to bow our heads and come to you in this blessing that we have called prayer. Father, we're thankful for your word. We're thankful that we read in it that your children can come to you at any time, any hour, any minute of any day. But Father, may we always come with a humble heart, a thankful attitude, and realize, Father, that without you, that nothing would be possible. Father, we want to pray for those that we've mentioned this morning in a special way. We want to pray for June and Wayne, Chad Isaac's parents. As we understand Wayne's in the hospital, we pray that you bless them, be with them. Father, we have a whole list that we're thinking about. We pray for Danny Self. Father, we want to mention Skip and Danny. Please be with them. Father, we're thankful for the progress that Tyler Sutton has made. We continue to pray for him, and we just pray that you'll continue to bless him. Father, we pray for Nicholas Holbrook. We know that's an everyday struggle, and we just pray for him, his family. We pray for Lenny and Luke and Velvet in their recovery. Father, we want to always be able to mention folks in a public way that we need to pray for, and Father, even those that someone here this morning is even thinking about. We pray that you'll be with them and bless them. Father, we're so thankful that the damage was no more than it was in the Philippines. We pray that our brethren there can go out and aid those that are in need, and that glory can be brought to your name because of that. Father, we want to pray for Robbie Eversole as he continues to improve. We're thankful for him, our relationship with him, and we just pray that you'll bless him. Father, we're thankful for Matthew Sloan while he's in Memphis, learning to be a better gospel preacher. And Father, we're thankful for those that's come from here, as it were, we've been able to be blessed with the opportunity to aid them, and that's Tyler Cabalas. We pray that Taylor Cabalas, you'll be with him. Father, we'll continue to pray for Jonathan Jenkins, for the good work that he's doing. Father, we'll continue to pray for Drew and the good work that he's doing, as well as Tate and Jake and the good work that they're doing. Continue to please be with them. Father, we recently sold this property that the church owned for a number of years, and we're so thankful that that finally came and is now behind us. Father, we're just so grateful for that. Father, we pray that for our future, that if this world stands, things continue to be as they are, we pray that they are, that you'll bless this congregation. Father, that we can be a light to our friends, to this community, those that we know and that we can communicate with. We can help them understand your word and the path that you would have them, that you have all of us to be on while we're alive on this earth. Father, we know that heaven is real, and it awaits those that remain faithful, those that die faithful. Father, we know that there's, just as heaven is real, so is there a place called hell. Father, may each one of us on that final day when we stand in judgment, that we'll hear the words, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." Faithful. Father, may we remain faithful. And if we're not faithful at this time, may we make the corrections that we need to make, whether it's something of a public nature. Sometimes that's the way that it is, or if it's of a private nature, that they'll make those things right with you, their Father and our Father, and that we all can remain faithful for the rest of our days. Father, bless our country. Father, it seems like things are always in a mess. Maybe it's even worse now, and maybe, I don't know. Father, we just pray that you'll continue to bless our country. Father, bless the church that's in this country. May we always realize that this world, this country, this place is really not our home at all. That we truly are just passing through. And may we not get so attached to the things of this world that would in such a way that would distract us from what's really important, and that's living a faithful Christian life. Father, but each one of us fail you, and we do things, we say things, we think things, we leave good deeds undone so often. Father, it's called sin. For these things we repent of, and we just beg for your forgiveness, for your mercy. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Turn to number 328. 328. In verses 1, 2, and 4. In the hour of trial, 328.
In the hour of trial. With a lonely
We'll get your emblem cup prepared as we prepare to take the Lord's Supper. And to do that, I want to turn to 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, if you'd like to read along. 1 Corinthians 11, beginning in verse 23, going through 29. First Corinthians 11, verse 23. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do, as often as you drink, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." Here Paul says there are three things that we need to do when we partake of the Lord's Supper. First, we need to remember. We need to remember what Jesus did for us when he died on the cross. Two times it is recorded that Jesus said, "This do in remembrance of me," here by Paul and also by Luke in Luke chapter 22. And so as we eat this bread and drink of this fruit of the vine, we remember. We think back to the cross, to the awful price that Jesus paid for our sins. You know, if we occupy our minds with that, the suffering that he endured, it will help us to keep from being distracted, from being really irreverent, and thus bringing judgment on ourselves, as Paul speaks about. So we remember. Secondly, when we eat the supper, we proclaim. We proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. And so in a sense, we are, as we partake of the supper, preaching. We're preaching a sermon. It's a silent sermon, but you know, it's a profound way of saying, we believe in Jesus. We believe he died for our sins. And we believe that he has provided salvation for us, and we believe he's coming again. This is not our home. We're looking forward to that time when Jesus comes and we can go to be with him. And so by keeping this thought in our minds, we're really strengthening our resolve to be faithful until he comes. And then thirdly, Paul says when we eat the supper, we are to examine ourselves. It's not a time to look around and examine or investigate or inspect others and what they're doing or how they're living. It's a time of self-examination. It's a time for saying, in effect, how's my life going? Am I doing what's right? Am I going in the right direction? Is my attitude toward my fellow man what it needs to be? Is my attitude toward my brothers and sisters in church what it needs to be? All of this, all of these things really only take just a few moments of thought, but how important it is that we do these things so that we can observe this memorial feast in the right manner and, as Paul suggests, not bring judgment upon ourselves. So if you will, take your cup and let's prepare to partake of the bread. And as we do, let's give thanks. And Father, we do thank you for this time that we have each Lord's Day to come together and to remember what your Son Jesus suffered for us, to remember the tearing of his flesh and the shedding of his blood in order that we might have remission of our sins. We pray now as we partake of this bread that we will do so in remembrance of what he did, and also as we examine ourselves and proclaim his death until he comes, we give you thanks for this opportunity. Bless us now as we partake. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue with our thanks. Father, we thank you again for Jesus and the sacrifice he was willing to make in our behalf. We thank you for the shedding of his blood, which was done for the remission of our sins, and how thankful we are that we can have forgiveness, remission of our sins through his death. Bless us, Father, today and every day that we keep ourselves going in the right direction, that we keep our hearts pure, that we have the right attitude toward each other and our fellow man. And we just pray that you'll continue to be with us and bless us. In Jesus' name. As always, we have the opportunity to give. And if you haven't done that coming in, you can do it on your way out. Let's give thanks. Father, we do thank you for the blessings of our lives, both materially and especially spiritually. We realize, Father, that without thee, we would have literally nothing. We thank you for our lives. We thank you for the influence that we can have in this world, and we pray that we will use our influence for good. We pray now that you will bless us as we give, that the things that are done with these funds can have a tremendous influence on the community around us, even in spreading the gospel throughout the world and expanding the borders of your kingdom. Please bless us and be with us, we ask in Jesus' name.
Mark number 714, Psalm encouragement. Trust nobody. Or lesson, let's sing number 551. 551. Or lesson. Sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep for the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus the Lord. to sing. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will sing. Though they are slighting him, still he is waiting, waiting the pen and the child to receive. Lead with them earnestly, lead with them gently. He will forgive if they truly believe. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Rescue the perishing, duty demands it. Shrink for the labor the Lord will provide. Back to the narrow way, patiently wend them. Tell the poor one where the Savior has died. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save.
Well, I'm so glad that you are here. We appreciate your presence so very much. It may be that you are gathered together in the parking lot listening on the radio. We appreciate your presence here as well. I got some reports that there was a little extra static all over the radio this morning. I hope it's sort of fixed itself. There's a lot of things that can interfere with that signal, but I hope it gets out there nice and strong. It may be that we have people in the annex. I'm not sure about that. We do have it live streaming over there to relieve some of the social distancing problems that we have here in the auditorium. But I'm glad that you are here. It's great to be able to come together and worship today. I appreciate Kevin praying for young Matthew Sloan. I am very proud of the number of students that we have sent over to the Memphis School of Preaching to train in preaching the gospel, and also proud of the work that they're doing after they get out, the ones that are already done. We've got men really stretched out all over the South, of course, coming back here to Georgia and preach, but we've got men in Kentucky and Louisiana, and even my friend Scott Broughton from Bremen is over in the South Pacific doing mission work in American Samoa. And so we've got Georgia boys all over the world preaching the gospel. We're very thankful for that and thankful for their hard work. Matthew Sloan is not from this congregation, but he has a lot of connections here. You may hear me call him Ziggy. I've called him that since he was a kid. But he's always been very talented in his work preaching the gospel. He is training to do that even better at Memphis. And recently reached out to him and said, hey, why don't you tape us a devotional? And I'll put it on our Facebook page and share it to our brethren. He agreed to do that, so I'm looking forward to send that out to you hopefully very soon. So stay on the lookout for that. Pray for Ziggy and his family while they're training at the Memphis School of Preaching. I want to share a concept that is spread out over a couple of chapters in the book of Hebrews. Open your Bibles, if you will, to Hebrews chapter 5. I want to show this concept to you and then talk about some ways that I think are important for us to apply this concept to our lives today. And it is simply this, the concept that Christians should never be satisfied with where they are.
Amen.
We ought to want to improve. We ought to want to do better. We ought to want to mature in the faith. And I think this is a very important time for us to be thinking about that concept. A time where we're separated more than we normally are. A very strange time in our country because of this pandemic and the pressures that it has put on not just the world, not just society, but also on the church. The question is, what is going to happen to the church during this time? Are we going to get stronger? Are we going to stay the same? Are we going to decline? The truth is, it's up to us. It's up to us as individuals. I don't mean as a congregation. The elders are not going to get together and say, Are we going to decline during this time and make that decision? That's not the way it's going to happen. This is something that is going to be decided by each and every one of us personally, because that is what makes up the strength of the congregation. I know you've heard the idea that we're only as strong as our weakest link. It's that way in a chain. It's that way in a congregation as well. And it's not to say that if we have one weak link that the church all is weak, but because of our love for one another, we don't want anyone to be weak. We want to benefit and boost up and strengthen everybody in the congregation.
Amen.
And so I want to show you this concept and the way that the Hebrews writer sets it forth here in chapters 5 and 6 of the book of Hebrews. And I don't have time to read every verse in these chapters to you, but I encourage you, when you have the opportunity, to study this deeper in its context, and you will appreciate the meaning of these things even more. But in Hebrews chapter 5, the Hebrews writer is holding up the idea of Jesus as our great high priest. And the point that he makes in the first part of chapter 5 is, people don't volunteer to be high priest. They're chosen by God. It depended in the Old Testament on who you were. You see, God chose Aaron and his descendants to serve as high priests. And so this is the idea here. In chapter 5, verse 1, it says, "For every high priest is taken from among men, is ordained for men in things pertaining to God, that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sins." And so the idea, that verse then focuses on the work that is done by the high priest. And look at verse number 4. It says, "No man taketh this honor unto himself, but he that is called of God, as was Aaron." And so, an average Jew in the Old Testament didn't look around and say, "You know what, I volunteered to be high priest for a year." That's not the way it worked. You were chosen by God depending on who you were. Look at verse 5. "So also Christ glorified not himself to be made a high priest, but he that hath said unto him, Thou art my son, today have I begotten thee." And so, again, Jesus didn't volunteer, "I'll be high priest." He was chosen to be high priest by God because he was the son of God. He was the only one that could serve as our high priest, and he certainly did so willingly. But the point of that is, he was selected by God to do the things that he did. And so, the emphasis here is Jesus' relationship with the Father and his existence as God in the flesh. And so I think that is the foundation that the rest of this concept is built upon. And it's sort of interesting. Look down at verse number 8. It says, "Though he were a son," that is the Son of God. Now think about what that means for a moment. He was God. He was deity in the flesh. Jesus possessed then every characteristic of deity. Omniscience and omnipotence and omnibenevolence and everything else that God, it makes up God. Jesus had that. Because he is God. He is God. He was God. Continues to be God. But notice, "Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered." Isn't that an interesting idea? Jesus is perfect, he is God, and yet here the Bible says he's learning some things. Well, I think this passage is emphasizing, of course, the human side of Jesus. He was God in the flesh, but when he came to this low land of sin and sorrow, he learned some things by experience. He learned by doing the things that he suffered. Because God knows everything, before he ever was beat with a whip or nailed to the cross, he knew what suffering was, but he never experienced it until he went through it himself. Knowledge, just knowledge, is not a substitute for doing. He shows us that here in Jesus. Verse 9 says, "And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him." Now, what does that mean there? How could Jesus be made perfect or become more perfect when he was already God? Well, the idea there, again, is that he became more complete, more mature in experiencing those things that God had planned for him. And that's the idea of being made perfect, complete, or to the highest level of maturity. Now, you need to watch that, because Jesus is going to be held up, of course, as an example for us to continue to mature, to continue to become more complete as time goes on. He wasn't satisfied with where he was. He had to follow God's plan. And we need to be the same way there, don't we? And so it says that he was called of God and high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Look at verse number 11, what the Hebrews writer says here. "Of whom we have many things to say, and hard to be uttered, seeing ye are dull of hearing," the King James says. And so the Hebrews writer says, look, there's a lot of things I could say about Jesus Christ and his being a high priest of the order of Melchizedek. I would love to teach you about those things, but you're dull of hearing. You're not ready to hear those things. They should have been. You see, the Hebrews writer was writing to a group of Christians who should have been doing better than they were. Now, I'll submit to you the concept that if that was true back then, it could be true today as well. We could be a group of Christians who ought to be doing better than we are, who ought to want to be doing more than we are. That was certainly true of them. He says, "For when for the time ye ought to be teachers," verse 12, "ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not strong meat." That was not a compliment. He said, you ought to be ready to eat meat, and instead I'm having to continue to feed you milk. I ought to be able to preach to you about Jesus being a high priest of the order of Melchizedek, but you're not ready for that because you're still babes. You're still little babies needing milk instead of needing the meat of God's word. "Everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil." You see the connection there in verse 14? Thrown in contrast to what he's been talking about earlier in the chapter about Jesus. He says the way that you grow, the way that you mature, the way that you do better is to exercise your senses to discern good and evil. And then when you do that, when you better study the Word of God and better figure out the things that you need to be doing that are good, you need to exercise by doing those things. Just like Jesus became more complete, more mature, he became perfect by the things that he experienced. And so we've got to do the things that are right in order to grow and do better. And then chapter 6 ties right in. You know that men divided up the Bibles into chapters and verses, not God. And so sometimes these chapters just follow right. There shouldn't even be a break in there. But he is going to sort of move on to his conclusion after setting up these facts in chapter 6 and verse number 1. He says, "Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection." Now, when he says it's time for us to leave the principles of the doctrine of Christ, what he means by that is we've got to move on from the simple things. I've used the illustration before. It's kind of like when you send your little child to kindergarten. And they learn their colors, and they learn to count to 10, and they learn their ABCs. And then they go on to first grade. It's not that they forget everything that they learned in kindergarten. They just build on those things. And it's like that all the way up through school. No teacher ever says, now forget everything you learned last year, or everything up until this point. No, they build on the knowledge that's already there. And so he says, it's time for us to move on from the simple things to the more complex things. It's time for us to do better. It's time for us to grow and to mature. Now, when you read the rest of that verse, it sets a pretty high bar for what he calls the simple things. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and faith toward God, of the doctrines of baptisms and of laying on of hands and of resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. Those things seem pretty weighty to me, but he calls them the simple things that we need to be moving on from and building on in our lives in order to mature and to do better.
Amen.
Now, I want you to notice verse number 3, which is key, of chapter 6. And this we will do if God permit. You see, it's not an option. It's not grow and mature and do better if you want to. No. For Christians, it's we have to. This we will do if God permits. We've got to grow. Not just in number, but in strength spiritually. We've got to grow spiritually as God's people. Now, somebody says, well, here you are preaching to the ones that are here every Sunday. That's true. You know, part of the biggest work that a preacher does is figuring out what he needs to be preaching on to the people that are listening to him. But in these days of pandemic, when we're streaming live on Facebook and recording these things on the internet forever, you never know who's going to be hearing these lessons. And so we have to, I think preachers have got to preach in a more general way. But really, it doesn't matter who we are. If we're Christians, we ought to want to do more, shouldn't we? We ought to want to strive to do better and get stronger. And this we will do. You know, the importance of that verse is magnified if you understand the context of the book of Romans. Somebody might say to Dale, well, this is a hard time to get stronger. This is a hard time to do better. This is a hard time to get more mature in our faith when we're separated in times of pandemic and we're not able to worship as much as we used to and all these things. You know what? The book of Hebrews was written to Christians who were going through times of terrible persecution and affliction. This was written during a time where Christians' families and communities were putting so much pressure on them that many of them were leaving Jesus Christ. They were leaving the church and going back to Judaism. And so, don't tell me that we can't grow during times of stress. Don't tell me we can't mature during times of affliction, because that's exactly what the Hebrews writer expected these people to do in response to this teaching from the Word of God. He was inspired. It's not a question of can we do it. He says, this we will do if God permit. I think if God permits there means if we live. Some of them were about to be killed for what they believe. Now, it hasn't gotten to that point yet here. We don't know what the future holds, though. Chances are Christianity may be persecuted in the future. If you look back through history, though, what you'll find is during times of persecution, that's when the church grew stronger.
Amen.
Maybe that's what it's going to take for us to grow stronger. I hope not. I hope we can do it even during the good times. Not very often, if you look back through the stream of time, that God's people got stronger during the good times. But it can happen. And we can get stronger during these times. But even in times of persecution, we can do better, and we should do better. That's what he says here. This we will do if God permit. What a great motto. What a great marching order for us. This we will do. Because it's not an option. God says we have to, and we will. You know, if you read a little bit further down in that passage, down in verse number 10, it says, "For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love." Well, that's true on its face, isn't it? God is not unrighteous. If you were to stop right there, you'd say, well, that's self-evident. God is God. The point he's making there is, for God to overlook the good that you're doing, for God to overlook your faithfulness and your maturity and your spiritual growth, it would be unrighteous, wouldn't it? That's not how God is. He sees everything. He knows everything. And when we improve, when we get stronger spiritually, God knows that. And he blesses us because of it. God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love. Don't ever think God's not watching. You see, it's interesting to me that he starts out by saying, you need to look at Jesus and see how he lived and see how he grew in spite of being God. See how he obeyed even when it was hard. And then you need to remember that Jesus is looking at you to see how you're going to respond. How are you going to improve? How are you going to mature? You look at Jesus because Jesus is looking at you. It says here, which ye have shown toward his name, and that ye have ministered to the saints and do minister. Part of improving, part of getting more mature, is ministering. That doesn't mean standing up behind a pulpit and preaching the word of God. It might include that, but that's not what it means. Minister in this context means helping. We need to be helping others. That's one way that we show our improvement in the faith, our maturity in the faith, by doing more for helping others. He says in verse number 11, and we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end. Because it's not optional, it's something every one of us has to do. We desire every one of you to show the same diligence. What kind of diligence? The diligence to minister to others and to grow and to mature and to become stronger and more perfect like Jesus. We'll never be sinlessly perfect like Jesus was. But the idea is to get better, to get stronger, to become more mature day by day. Sometimes I use the phrase, be more faithful. That's a little bit of a misnomer because, you know, when a babe in Christ comes up out of that watery grave, he is just as faithful as he can be on that very day when he obeys the gospel. Now, is he going to learn more? You bet. And because he learns more, is he going to do more? You bet. More mature, more advanced, more complete. But he's already faithful. We all need to be faithful all the time, but that doesn't mean that we can't improve.
Amen.
And that's what this lesson is about. It's about improving and doing better. Now, what does that look like, though? Well, That's one of those questions that you best answer for yourself. But like every other question, it takes some effort and some diligence to think about. You know, we talk sometimes about you don't accidentally become a Christian. You don't accidentally make it to heaven. I heard a fellow say, you don't accidentally climb to the top of a mountain. It's work. And for us to improve in the faith, we have to ask ourselves, what does it look like for me to become more faithful? Does it look like me setting aside time during the day, every day, to read my Bible more so I can know the areas that I need improvement in? Does it mean that I set aside just a little more time during the day to strengthen my prayer life? You know, I've never met a Christian who said, you know, I'm completely satisfied with where my prayer life is. We can always improve in that area, can't we? So we study more, we pray more, we reach out to our friends and our neighbors more. How many Bible studies have we set up? How many offers have we made to go to people's home and study with them, sit down at the table with them, the kitchen table, and show them what the Bible says about some of these important questions that they might have in their lives because of the way the world is right now? Reach out more, study more, pray more, attend services more, do more ministering to those that are in need. Those people around you that nobody else might even know about, but you know about, have a need. Help meet that need. That's what it looks like to be more faithful. That's what it looks like to be stronger. That's what it looks like to be more mature in the faith and get better day by day. And you don't have to worry. You don't have to toot your own horn and blast it around and say, I'll be high priest, I'll be high priest. God sees it all. He knows what you're doing, and He'll bless you because of it. You don't worry about God's part. You just worry about your part. God will take care of His part. If you're here today and you want to become a child of God, there's no better time than right now. No better time than the present. The reason for that is this is the time that we know that we have. You can obey the gospel today. Hear, believe, repent, confess, and be baptized. You say, you went through that too fast. Well, then walk down that aisle and say you want to study it slower, and we'll study it slower. We'll look at every verse to back up every step of the plan of salvation. And you can know what you need to do, and you can do it before you leave here today. And if you're a Christian, you realize that maybe you drifted away from the truth, you haven't been growing like you should, and it's just like in the physical realm. For a little baby to be born into this world, if they're not growing, something's wrong. If you're not growing, friend, something's wrong. You can come back through repentance and prayer, and we'll pray with you and for you and help you in every way that we can. And if it's just between you and God, take care of it that way. But if we can pray for you publicly, all you have to do is let us know. We'll be glad to help you. Don't leave here lost. Let us know what we can do right now as together we stand and as we sing.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all obey, trust and obey, for there's no other
Such a fantastic lesson. It was a great message, Rick. Thank you. It's very encouraging for all of us to improve each and every day, really each and every hour, as we work on all the things that God's Word teaches us to do as a Christian. After, in a previous announcement, after hacking the announcement of Tyler and Autumn's fourth upcoming child and referring to Brady's new brother or sister, I messed that up. And it's not a little boy, it's a little girl. So trust me, I know now. My wife straightened me out on that. And we pray that's coming along just fine, as we got grandmama and great grandmama standing over there. And they're smiling, so it looks like it's going good. And then we got another first. Today we were blessed to be in the presence of Ambria and Logan's new son, Sutton Reese. Now, isn't that a beautiful name?
Amen.
Oh, the Sutton clan said amen. So that's, you know it's good, don't you? That's beautiful. And we pray for that child and mom and dad and also for Tyler and Autumn and the birth of their upcoming daughter. So let's all, in these tough times this year that we were experiencing, 2020 may go down in history as being one of the toughest that we've been through in a while. I don't think you've ever been through a pandemic. I know I haven't. So stay strong, stay faithful, hang in there, because if you're not closer to God today than you were yesterday, guess who moved? Because He's not going to move.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we come before Your throne of grace, thanking You for the privilege of being at this worship service. Father, we pray for those that were not able to come. And we're thankful for those that were able to come but attended in the parking lot. And we appreciate that, and we understand that. In this pandemic era, we pray that as the coronavirus is still lurking close, we pray for the vaccine. We're thankful for those doctors and scientists and all those workers that are helping to make that possible. We pray that that will get ever closer, and that the therapies for conquering coronavirus, the treatments will be improved each and every day. We know that has come a long way, Father, and we're thankful because You provide the way, Father. Father, we pray for our country, we pray for our leaders, we pray for our community. We're thankful, Father, for Brother Rick and his family. May You be with them and bless them. And we pray for each and every one that is on our prayer list. And plus, Father, we know there are many that we haven't mentioned or that maybe we don't even know about. We pray that You would help them. As we depart from this building, we pray that our worship has been a blessing and an honor to uplift Your name, Father, above all names. May we have been taught. May we have had an opportunity to give. Father, we thank You for the brethren. Father, we pray that as we leave this place, we will depart from here to serve You. And as the lesson today from Hebrews has taught us, to understand that You're in charge and that Your ways are the only way. May we go to serve. In Jesus' name, we ask these things. Amen.
Amen. Amen.